let's talk about the raw format, which is basically all the information that the sensor sees recorded into a file. Normally, when you're shooting with your phones, point-and-shoot cameras, or even shooting JPEG on a DSLR, it makes a raw file. Every digital camera makes a raw file. It's just all the data that the sensor sees. And then it processes that raw file into an image, and it saves that onto the memory card as a JPEG compressed image. But when you're shooting in RAW, you have the option to make some changes after the fact. The cool thing about the RAW format, there's a little bit of exposure correction. If you're shooting in JPEG, and let's say that sunlight is reflecting off the bride's shoulder and all that beadwork and lace, the highlights are starting to blow out. And if you're losing that highlight detail, you pretty much can't get it back in JPEG. But in the RAW format, there's a little bit of leeway, a little bit of extra information in there. And you can take advantage of that. And here's what we're gonna do today. There's two different images we're gonna work on. We're gonna start with this guy in the jungle here, shot 6089. And the exposure is good on the guy, but the client wants the background to be a little bit darker. They want the foreground to be a little bit brighter. Now, because it's a RAW file, it's not actually an image. So give this a try. Once you get the folder, look into the folder called Combining Multiple Processes. And this file here, shot 6089.cr2. If you double click it, it'll launch Photoshop and it'll open up in this window here. This is called Adobe Camera Raw, or often people just refer to it as ACR. In this case, what the client wants is this background darkened down a little bit. See how bright it is back here? The subject is nicely exposed. They say, oh, subject looks great, but we want this background to be a little bit darker. And because this is about the clothing, look down below the knees there. You can see a little bit of shadow detail, but they want that brightened up a little bit. In JPEG, I'd be limited as to how much of a change I could make. But because this is a RAW file, we can stack this up. We can basically take this RAW file and process it multiple times. Give this a try. First, make sure that there's no changes done to it. So just open up the RAW file and click Open Image, and that'll pass it through right into Photoshop. And we have one version of the image where he looks properly exposed, but the background is a little bit too bright. Well, let's make a different version of that image. Go back to the RAW file, so pop back into the Finder or wherever you got the RAW file from, and double click it again. It'll open back up in ACR, in Adobe Camera Raw, and this time, let's take the exposure slider and darken it down a little bit. And this time, we're gonna take that exposure down by maybe like minus a stop or so. A stop in photography is one unit of brightness. So by taking this down to minus one, you can see that he's gotten a little bit darker, but the background looks better. So now, once we open up this darker version, we have two versions of this image open. So I'm gonna hit Open Image here. And if I look at my stack, I've got the 089.cr2 and another one called 089-2. It gave it a different name because it can't use the same name for two files that are open. So this was the .cr2, this one it just calls it -2. This one is darker. We want this background to be visible on this image. Now, how are we going to get this darker version over onto the lighter version? Well, there's a bunch of ways we could do it. We could go select all, edit, copy, and that would copy all these pixels, pop over to the lighter document and simply paste it in. The downside to copying and pasting is it takes up RAM. You guys know what RAM is on your computer? It's whatever it's using to think about what you're doing at the moment. There's two types of storage in your computer. There's your RAM. Most computers have like 8, maybe 16 gigabytes these days. Better ones might have 32. I came from the days back, my first computer had 8 megabytes. Actually, my very first computer was a Commodore VIC-20, had 4 kilobytes of RAM in it. So this is like, a million times more. Wow. Anyway, I'm really old. But if you use up too much RAM, it has to go to your hard drive and pretend that that's RAM. Your hard drive is really slow, so it really slows down your computer. So instead of copying it, we're simply gonna duplicate it over to the other document. Give this a try. Right click on the name background on that darker version of the image. Just right click on the name background, a little menu will pop up, and you'll see something that says duplicate layer. But we're not gonna duplicate the layer into the same document. Take a look at this window here. First off, it's asking, what do we want to call it? Well, I'm going to call this one darker. And then it's saying destination. Where do you want this layer to go? Well, from this pop-up, look at this. I can choose the CR2 version. That's the lighter version of the image. So from the destination, Under Document, I'll send it over to my 089.cr2 version. And when I hit OK, it looks like nothing has happened. There's my Layers panel. There's no duplicate layer in there. But if I go over to the 089.cr2 version, look at what you see in your Layers panel. So we got something like this, where we have the darker version on top. And look at that. You can see that nice dark foliage in the background there. And the background has the proper exposure of him, but the foliage is too light. How could we get this background to show with this foreground showing at the same time? Here's what we gotta do. We gotta get rid of this version of him. He's too dark here. The background looks good, but he's too dark. Layer masks, what do they do?
Hide or reveal.
They mask the layer below. So if we were to fill a layer mask with black, it would completely hide this darker version, wouldn't it? Well, where do we get layer masks from? The mask store?
At the very bottom.
At the very bottom of the layers panel. Yeah, there you go. It looks like a rectangle with a little gray circle in the middle of it. If you hover over it, it'll say add layer mask. If you click it, kaboom. It gives you a white or a reveal all layer mask. Okay. Now, this layer mask is completely revealing the darker layer. What if we filled this layer mask with black? Or here's a fast way to fill it with black. Notice it's filled with white right now. If we were to invert an image, it would become basically a photographic negative of itself. So red would become cyan, blue would become yellow, and white would become black. The keyboard shortcut for inverting, and we could go the long way and go image, adjustments, invert. But the keyboard shortcut, Command I. So make sure that this layer mask is selected. See those little four white corner things around it? And do Command I. And that'll fill that layer mask. Boink. With black. You'll notice when you did it, it looked like it got brighter. What happened is it hid the darker version of the image. What do you think we could use to bring back the darker, to make it visible again? Black hid it. What if we were to paint with white? If you grab a paintbrush, guys, just hit B on the keyboard, is your shortcut for brush. And when you're working on a layer mask, you do want to make sure that you're painting with pure black and pure white as your foreground and background colors. We could click this icon here. That'll give you your default colors. But there's a keyboard shortcut that you can hit that will give you your default colors. Any idea what that shortcut might be? Just hit D on the keyboard. That way you know you've got pure black and pure white. So hit D on the keyboard. We also want to make sure we're painting at 100% opacity. Fast way to do that, hit 0. On the keyboard. There's your 100% opacity. And watch this. If I paint with white paint, it looks like I'm darkening, which seems really counterintuitive. Wait a minute, I'm painting with white paint and I'm darkening the background? It's not that I'm darkening the background. It's that that white paint is revealing the darker image. Wherever I paint with white, that darker image becomes visible. In fact, if you want to see exactly what's going on, turn off the eyeball on the background layer. Wherever we paint with white, we're bringing back the darker layer. And if we go too far, oops, I didn't mean to bring him back. If I hit X on the keyboard, notice how it reverses my foreground and background colors. Now I have black, which means I can hide that layer. And the great thing about using a layer mask instead of simply erasing those pixels is if I realize I've made a mistake, went too far, I can bring them back very easily. Like, look at this tree. Oops, I accidentally darkened the tree, and the client calls me up and says, why has that tree been darkened? I'm like, no problem. I'll just grab some black paint, and I will hide that darker version. So by hitting X on the keyboard, we can hide and reveal as needed. So now we've got a version of the image, and if you want to see a before and after, turn off the eyeball on the top layer. Here's before. This is how it looked when we first opened it up in Camera Raw, and the client's like, that background's too light. We've darkened it down. And we did it using the raw data. Sure, we could have, in theory, put on like an adjustment layer or something, but if some of those highlights had been blowing out, once it's blown out to white, you can't bring any detail back. So this is one of the neat things about the RAW format. Now, what format would we save this in once we're done with it?
PSD.
PSD. We want to keep those layers intact.